Man, one of my favorite guys to talk boxing with, Andre Rozier. Man, you just told everybody I knew it. I knew about you. But tell them, you know how you do. You sew up your outfits and you made the outfit for Paulie. Well, and you're one of the biggest names in the business for doing that. And nobody knows.
No, I mean, everyone, it's almost like the quiet storm. I'm here on a clothing run. Tonight, yeah. I'm enjoying the fights. I'm not here in a trainer capacity. Mm-hmm. I'm here to just enjoy what's going on. And I happen to have made the uniform for Paulie Malignaggi and for Ilio Rojas. So we have two Havoc pieces in the house. Havoc all the way. You know, it's, we are in the hurt business. And somebody going to get hurt up in here. And it is what it is.
People got to be kind of thrown off when they find out, you know, that you're a trainer. And I mean, what would be the term? Seamstress? I don't really know.
Oh, tailor.
Okay, tailor.
Only when people want to make fun of me, they say seamstress.
Oh, okay. All right.
But no, seriously speaking, I've been doing this a long time. I've been creating fashion for a long time. It's one of my first loves. God has given me the ability and the capability to manifest my actual creativity in fighters and in fashion.
All right, so moving on from fashion to boxing, let's talk about, you know, your star, Danny Jacobs. He was pretty vocal about, you know, a month ago during Thurman Porter that he was not interested in more of two, you know? But it's happening, et cetera, et cetera. Is that more of, you know, politics? Like, what's the reasoning behind this?
To honestly tell you, I don't even know. I didn't want to fight Sergio Mora again. We already fought him. Regardless of the outcome of him hurting his leg and everything else, he was still going to be knocked out. We went on to knock out Kid Chocolate right after that. Why are we revisiting that crime? We took care of that. The police arrived. The coroner was there, the whole nine yards. But if we have to, then it's going to be homicide all over again.
He's also been pretty vocal about Triple G's choice of opposition, you know, and that he wants to be that's the super fight. He's made it known that that's the fight. He's not afraid of it. He just wants to get paid, you know. He said he was talking to Tom Loeffler last time that they were there. What's the inside scoop? What's going on there? Is that possible? Like,
it's going to happen. It's going to happen. It has to happen. And even though in this world of fights that usually don't, that we want to see, this one we're going to make happen. And people are going to be super duper surprised because Danny is not that guy that Triple G is used to seeing. He's mobile, he's fast, and he can punch. So he's not going to be sitting there waiting for Triple G to throw shots at him. That's not going to happen. And I honestly believe that the world will be so surprised at the outcome, it's not even funny.
So maybe something within the next three fights? I mean, that's a long time,
big
right?
Bro? Without a doubt. I think...
throw a Canelo in there? I mean, there's not so many big-time middleweights.
Canelo will never fight either one of them, so let's not even talk about Canelo. And I love Canelo, don't get me wrong, but he's not fighting. I say maybe fall of 2017. That's what I'm looking for, fall of 2017. If we can get it on then, it'd be great. Well, I honestly don't want that fight to be 2-3 years from now because then when we go in, we win, and then all of a sudden, he got old on us and this, that, and the other. I don't want that. Let's get them when they're primed and let's do it. Let's make it work.
Behind the scenes, is Danny vocal about that kind of thing? Does he tell you, like, man, I wish we could just, you know, do this in a backyard? Like, I just want to get him.
Oh, yeah, because he gets so many people, so many critics, so many haters riding him. Of course, he wants to cement his place in the middleweight picture. The only way for that to happen is for the two best middleweights to meet. And that's... Danny Jacobs and Triple G.
Yep, right there. I mean, speaking of which, what do you think of the move up from Kell Brook?
I think it's courageous. I think it's...
Is it a payday or is it, you know, heart?
Well, it's more than a payday because it takes a lot. He knows this guy is a real killer. So for him to even want to fight him at 160, no less, I give him all the credit in the world. All the credit. He's a dog. Mm-hmm. He's a real dog. And he went from somebody who I just briefly spoke about to one of my favorite dudes.
All right. So what does it say for Triple G on the flip side of that?
Well, I mean, Triple G's looking for them for the fights that's going to make him some money. I can't hate on him for that, but on the same note, Mr. Triple G is always, or better yet, Mr. Abel, his trainer, is always speaking for him. I would think that they would have fought somebody like Andre Ward when the time was right. Now, Ward is going on to meet Kovalev, who he is going to beat. And you'll never see Triple G fight him then. So we can forget about that. Ward will probably be going up to heavyweight.
Wow.
And he's just that talented. I call him my nephew, and he's one of my favorite fighters. There's no secret about that. And he's going to keep climbing. So that fight will never happen. We need to forget about it. But Ward is very special.
There's another big fight at that same weight class, 175. He just fought yesterday, Adonis Stevenson. Spectacular knockout. People have been clamoring up until Ward turned 175. The fight at 175 was Superman versus Crusher.
Right.
You know, now with that knockout yesterday, people actually are, you know, and based on the knockout yesterday and based on Kovalev's performance with Chalemba, people are saying that, you know, Stevenson might have his number. What do you think about that fantasy
fight? Well, I'll put this together for you. Kovalev and Ward are destined to meet. Ward beats Kovalev. Adonis has no other direction or choice but to fight Ward. Ward beats Adonis Stevens.
Wow.
Then Kovalev and Adonis can fight. But it doesn't matter. There's a new king in the light heavyweight division, and that's Andre Ward. He's going to beat Kovalev. He's going to beat Adonis Stevens. He is the man.
How much do you think Ward will pressure the WBC to make them, you know, mandate that fight?
Well, I think the people will push for it at that point, because he's going to be really like the top dog. And I don't see anybody not favoring him to beat Adonis after he beats Kovalev. So here we are. A new king is crowned.
Talk to me a little bit about Danny Swift Garcia, Andre Berto.
Well, I love both of them. Danny Garcia has represented Havoc for about 3 years now, and some of the baddest gear that I've put my hands on. I can't help but love him to death. And Berto has also. So, it's a tough fight, either way it goes.
A little bit of the Havoc bias?
Yeah, you know, because they both supported Havoc, so it's not even that, but I mean, they're both my dudes, and honestly, I gotta switch into Uncle Dre mode, and I gotta sit back and be neutral.
Just enjoy it.
Neutral as the car with the stick shift in that slot that missed going into the first gear. I gotta be neutral. I think it's gonna be a great fight if it happens, and I'm looking forward to it.
Going back to light heavy, almost forgot about your boy Marcus Brown, man. Where does he fit into that equation after, you know, his fight with a Hot Rod?
Well, yeah. Marcus Brown is one of the most talented light heavyweights in the division. He really is. And he just needs to find his way a bit more. And as you can see, when he fought Campillo, he was utterly destructive. And that's the Marcus we want to see all the time.
Mm-hmm.
All we need to do is get it there, and we're going to be good. And that's what I'm looking forward to happening with Marcus. I'm looking for Nephew to be that guy, because he has everything. He has the speed, the size, the punching capability. He has it all. He just needs to manifest it in the ring, and we'll be fine.
It's not signed, sealed, and delivered yet, but Terrence Crawford's spectacular performance against Victor Postal, return of Manny Pacquiao, those two worlds collide. How do you see it going down? Terrence Crawford, Manny Pacquiao.
Terrence Crawford beats Manny Pacquiao.
Stoppage, knockout.
I don't think he will. I don't think he's going to stop him, but he's going to outbox him for sure.
Is that something that can bring Floyd back? Can somebody, you know, beating Pacquiao in that manner, you know, bring Floyd out of retirement?
I don't think so, because I think Floyd enjoys what Terrence Crawford does. It's almost like an emulation.
Mm-hmm.
And when someone emulates you, you don't think about, oh, you know what, I'm going to... You enjoy their movement. You enjoy their ability in the ring. And I think Floyd is watching Terrence and saying, hey, God, that reminds me of me. So I don't think that'll happen, but Crawford definitely beats Manny Pacquiao.
Tell all your fans where they can find you, reach out, you know, maybe even get some cool threads.
Listen, I am all over the place, and I'm over in Bay Ridge at New York City Fight Club. That's where we train at. Gary Stark Sr. and myself, a.k.a. the Mama Luke Brothers. And if you need me, just call me, 347-236-7730. I'm here.
Well, there you go. I can't get more personal than that. Damn, Andre, appreciate your time. Always.
Love,
thank you.
Love.
Appreciate you.
What the